Hey there.
Good morning.
Oh, good morning, Ymir. How are you?
Good. How are you?
Good. Good to see you.
It's great to see you as well.
Right. Very good. Are you right on time. And I was getting a little bit nervous, but...
No, I'm sorry. I was a minute behind.
No, it's fine. We are just about to start. We're actually live now, but we can talk a little bit. So here's what I'm going to do. We're all going to go on mute. And then at the top of the hour, in about 2 minutes, I'm going to do my 5-minute intro, and then I'm going to introduce you, and then we'll go into the questions, all right?
Perfect.
Okay. Good to see you.
Thanks again. For coming on. Absolutely. All right.
One, two, three. Okay. All right. Hello, everyone, and welcome to this Wi-Fi Now special event on 6 gigahertz Wi-Fi for Brazil. My name is Klaus Hetting, and I'm the CEO and chairman of this organization. I am totally excited and delighted to be your host for this 2-day special event. In fact, if you are in any way interested in 6 gigahertz Wi-Fi, you have come to the right place. We have prepared a fantastic program for you that will cover everything you need to know, of course, about 6 gigahertz for Brazil specifically. But more than that, we will cover a lot of ground on regulation and technology that applies not only to Brazil, but also to the Americas in general. So, indeed, much of what we will cover here applies broadly to the case for 6 gigahertz Wi-Fi everywhere. So there's a wider perspective to this event as well. So we're coming to you, by the way, live from our studios in Aarhus, Denmark, which is where the Wi-Fi Now organization is headquartered. And of course, during this event, we will be connecting to speakers in Brazil, of course, as well as speakers from other parts of the Americas, including from the US. So let me get straight to the point. So last week, Thursday, Brazilian regulator Anatel voted 5-0 in favor of releasing the full 6 gigahertz band to Wi-Fi. This is as many of you will probably know, is a hugely important decision that will without a doubt define wireless connectivity in Brazil for at least a decade and probably for much longer than that. So when we originally organized this event and set the date, we were not totally sure when Anatel's decision would be made. And we thought of this event as a means to support and advocate for 6 gigahertz Wi-Fi. And we're still going to do that, of course, because that's what we do. But now we also hope that all of you out there, as well as our speakers will join us to celebrate this landmark decision that was made last week by Anatel. It certainly deserves both major international recognition and celebration. So in the course of the next 2 days, we will do a deep dive into the what and why of the decision, and not least discuss and understand the impact that this new regulation will have, first of all, on common connectivity for Brazil. But we're also digging into all the details on what 6 gigahertz Wi-Fi will mean generally speaking, for the world of tech. We will do this in the course of the next 2 days, specifically for about 2.5 hours today and tomorrow. We'll probably go over, so bear with us. And it's exactly the same time slot tomorrow. So today, we will have keynotes by Anatel and the FCC, and as well as by our Wi-Fi technology, international Wi-Fi technology leaders, Intel, Cisco, Amazon. Then we will have a deeper dive into the regulatory landscape for 6 gigahertz Wi-Fi with the Wi-Fi Alliance, with the Dynamic Spectrum Alliance, and also with us today is the Vice Minister of Telecommunications for the Republic of Chile. We're honored that she's with us today. Tomorrow, we will continue with more great speakers, including the GSMA, the IDC will be here, Facebook, Oi, the Brazilian service provider will be with us, CommScope, and many others. So make sure you also set your calendar to watch the second half of our event tomorrow at the same time. All right. So as of last count, we have on our side, meaning viewers directly registered with us, something like a couple of hundred folks watching. And on the Brazilian side, as far as I know, my producer just told me we got maybe close to more than 300, which is great. So we're super happy about that. That is happening through our Brazilian media partner, Convergência Digital. And anyway, so wherever you are across the world watching this, huge welcome to all of you. So just a couple of housekeeping items. We are trying to make available to you simultaneous translation into Portuguese. So if you want to listen to the Portuguese version of this broadcast, use the live podcast stream embedded below and mute this video viewer, this video and audio viewer stream. It's the first time we're doing this live translation in this kind of setup. So if there's a glitch or two, please bear with us. You may also want, in the worst case, to reload the webpage or click again on the play button if something goes wrong, if it gets stuck or something. But it should, we tested it and it seemed to be working fine at the time. Also, if you want to see the full program, written program as to the agenda, there's a link below this viewer where you can click on it, that you can click on to get the PDF. And very important, if you have questions, by the way, we like questions and we welcome them, please send them to my producer. She sits right next to me here. Her email is maria@wifinowevents.com. And we will try to get to them if we can. We have a tight program, but I promise you that we will try. I should also say that we're very conscious of the fact that many of our speakers will be presenting in a language that is not their native language, and we're sensitive to that. And we thank you, dear speakers, for being courageous enough to do that. That is a big thing. I, for one, would not want to present in Portuguese or Spanish. So we thank you for that. And so thank you for your willingness. All right, so let's get started. I am delighted to introduce our first speaker, who is in fact our special guest today. He's from the US Federal Communications Commission. His name is Umair Javed, and he's chief counsel for acting chairwoman of the FCC, Jessica Rosenworcel. So Ms. Rosenworcel could not be with us today, but we're delighted that our chief counsel is here, of course. So Umair, huge welcome to you. I think you're on there and we just need to have you switch on the video. There he is. Umair, welcome, great to see you.
Great to see you as well. Thanks for having me.
And first of all, huge thanks for coming on. And we're delighted that you could come on. And we did ask Ms. Jessica to join us. She's not always available, but what a great replacement. And we're so happy that you're here. I have a few questions for you about the decision on 6 gigahertz of course for the US. And I think I'm just going to jump right into them. Are you good with that?
That sounds great.
All right. So in April of 2020, the FCC adopted new rules that made 1200 megahertz of spectrum in the 6 gigahertz band available for unlicensed use. This is the largest opening of spectrum for unlicensed in the FCC's history. And at the time, there were some proposals to reserve some of this spectrum for exclusive license use, but the FCC did not do that. So was this the right decision is the question.
Sure. And thank you, Klaus, for the introduction and for helping to organize this discussion. It's a pleasure to be here with all of you and an honor to be joined by the FCC's distinguished counterparts, obviously Commissioner and Vice President Pereira of Anatel and Vice Minister Gidi from the Republic of Chile. I hope you're all well and staying safe. And before I go any further, let me recognize and congratulate Anatel for its unanimous decision last week to open the full 6 gigahertz band for Wi-Fi. In doing so, Brazil also became the first country in the world to enable very low power use across the full band. That's very exciting. I've seen estimates that this decision could add up to $163 billion to the Brazilian economy over the next 10 years. And it also means that now the United States, Brazil, and Chile, together with South Korea, are leading the world in 6 gigahertz availability for Wi-Fi. Now, as you noted, Klaus, in the United States, much like Brazil, we opened the full 1200 megahertz of spectrum for new unlicensed use. And I do think this was the right decision. Our unlicensed bands have been an incredible source of innovation because they have democratized internet access, they've helped carriers manage their networks, and they've fostered all kinds of economic activity. And as Chairwoman Rosenworcel has noted in the past, these bands are the perfect sandbox for experimentation because here access doesn't require contract or permission. And the reality is that we need more spectrum for Wi-Fi. If anything, the coronavirus pandemic has put Wi-Fi at the center of nearly every aspect of our daily lives, from how we work, how we learn, how we see a doctor, how we connect with family and friends. And as fiber and cable and mobile and these other technologies all move to gigabit plus speeds, it's really the Wi-Fi router that's become the bottleneck to getting faster speeds inside the home. It's like moving from a superhighway to a gravel road. So we need a change. And we know that in the coming days, as much as 70% of 5G traffic could be offloaded to Wi-Fi. On top of that, a lot of the use cases that we're looking at that are going to build the demand and build the business cases for carriers to even deploy 5G networks, things like augmented and virtual realities or the Internet of Things, these are also going to depend on unlicensed links for some portion of their connectivity. So all of this means that in the United States, we found that anything less than the full 1200 megahertz for Wi-Fi just wouldn't cut it. 1200 megahertz means you get multiple wide channels that can offer gigabit plus speeds and deliver on the promise of next generation Wi-Fi 6. So it's a very long-winded way of saying that if we want to continue with our wireless leadership, we need to grow Wi-Fi 2 and 6 gigahertz is the place to do it.
That is an excellent answer, sir, and thank you for that. By the way, can I just throw in that the decision by the FCC was 5-0, which it was in Brazil as well, right? Which is great, just to show how much support there is for unlicensed these days. Let me ask you the next question. So how does the FCC actually strike the right balance between licensed and unlicensed use? Because of course you are out to license bright frequencies as well, right?
That's right. It's a great question. It's probably as much an art as it is a science, and it's never easy. I think we can all agree, though, that bridging the digital divide that persists in our countries, it's going to take the right mix of licensed and unlicensed spectrum. It's going to take a balance. Licensed spectrum is certainly important because it provides companies the certainty they need for their investments. And in the United States, it's true that we need more mid-band spectrum to support new technologies like 5G. In fact, Chairman Rosenworcel was one of the first voices all the way back in 2018 to say that the United States needed to pivot to mid-band. The evidence was compelling even back then. And with the close of the C-band auction this month, and Chairwoman Rosenworcel's recently announced plan to auction licensed spectrum in the 3.45 gigahertz band this year, we're now seeing that shift. But unlicensed spectrum is also critical. And historically in the United States, we have this legislative process and it's really overlooked the value of unlicensed spectrum in a lot of ways, because it gets low marks in this complicated scoring process at the Congressional Budget Office. But this accounting really misses the broader benefits of unlicensed spectrum to the economy that we know are there. Mm-hmm. And so Chairwoman Rosenworcel has long championed the idea that we need to do both. The idea that in any legislative effort or regulatory effort to increase the licensed spectrum pipelines, we also look for a cut for unlicensed, or what she previously has called the Wi-Fi dividend. And if we can do that, I think we can build a spectrum pipeline that's robust, that's reliable, and that's a real force in our economic future.
Excellent. And what do you think will be the impact on connectivity by the 6 gigahertz band, specifically, of course, in the US? Do you see Wi-Fi as continuing to play a complementary role in the 5G wireless ecosystem, for example?
Yeah, look, I'm excited. I think over the past few years, the debate around what many have called the race to 5G has really focused on mobile carriers and on the exclusively licensed kind of high band and mid band spectrum that the FCC has auctioned or has scheduled for auction. Mm-hmm. But much like cellular, what we're seeing is that Wi-Fi is also going through a generational evolution with Wi-Fi 6. And Wi-Fi 6 includes it's more range in your wireless network, it's fewer connection drops, it's better security, and of course, it's a lot faster than what's available today, offering up to gigabit plus speed. And what we're seeing in the United States, at least, is that there's already a lot of investment and activity around Wi-Fi 6. The FCC has started to approve the first Wi-Fi 6 devices, and those will be hitting the market soon. There are many more on the way, and we've already had models of phones that are already shipping with Wi-Fi 6 connectivity. So I think it's safe to say that Wi-Fi 6 technology will continue to play an important role in the next generation wireless ecosystem. It's got, especially for indoor applications, for enterprise applications, it has very favorable economics, it has high performance. I think that's a good reason to think that it's gonna stay a very attractive choice.
Yeah, absolutely, for sure. And by the way, I also think that the speed of the evolution has been extraordinary as far as Wi-Fi 6 is concerned.
And now it's on a faster cadence than mobile, if you think about it. Wi-Fi, we're looking maybe every 5 years. Mobile, it's usually around every 10 years. So I think that's absolutely right.
Yeah, I believe that as well. And now we're seeing a similar story with, of course, 6 gigahertz Wi-Fi and as that evolves in the US. So it's super, super promising. So what further areas of unlicensed regulation are you currently looking at the FCC?
Yeah, well, you know, the work is never done. And we're digging our shoes in. We're just getting started. I think in the United States, for starters, we do have more work to do on the 6 gigahertz band. We still have open proceedings on whether we should permit an additional class of very low power unlicensed devices to operate across the entire 6 gigahertz band. Again, that's something Brazil has already moved forward on, and we're looking at it in the United States as well. We've asked whether we should modify our rules to permit the low power Wi-Fi indoor devices to operate at a slightly higher power than what they were approved to operate at last year. We've asked for our standard power access points, and these are the devices that are subject to automatic frequency control, whether they should be used in mobile applications. So a lot of questions that we're still looking at the 6 gigahertz band that we need to make progress on. We've received the comments on these questions at this point. That cycle has closed. It's generated a lot of input. We're seeing a wide range of opinions, a lot of support for the proposals, and some opposing them as well. And we're currently evaluating that record and thinking about next steps. But we're also, outside of the 6 gigahertz band, we're also looking for other opportunities for unlicensed. And for years, Chairwoman Rosenwinkel has called for spectrum in the 5.9 gigahertz band to be made available for new unlicensed use. This previously was reserved for auto applications like the Intelligent Transport Service. The FCC did that last year. And some of the spectrum has already been put to use by wireless internet service providers who are actually using it to enhance connectivity to rural and underserved areas during the pandemic. So we're very excited about that. And finally, I think we're also taking action to build new momentum in TV white spaces. So back in 2008, the FCC suggested that instead of letting those unused portions of the traditional television spectrum just lay fallow and unused, that we would open them up for unlicensed use as well. And 12 years later, we're still working on that. And so while white space innovation started in the United States, it has actually in some ways progressed faster abroad. There's more than a dozen countries at this point offering the technology. So the good news is that the agency has updated some of its rules to provide new flexibility for TV white spaces in the United States, but we still have a lot of unresolved petitions. We still have questions around the service. And I think we're looking at how to clear up those issues so that we can put this spectrum to more intensive use for all.
Fantastic. And finally, Umair, first of all, thank you so much for coming. We have one final question for you on this list, and that's, do you have any advice or insights to offer our Brazilian colleagues who are going to speak? One of them are going to speak right after you in just a moment.
Sure. Only that I look forward to working with all of our counterparts to advance global spectrum policy. You know, at the FCC, we recognize that we succeed when we come with strong support and collaboration from our inter-American colleagues in North, Central, and South America. And I think this is already reflected in our work, in recommendations that reflect important compromises that really resonate at CTEL, that contribute to the regional ITU submissions, and that lead ultimately to globally harmonized rules that that benefit consumers. Under Chairwoman Rosenworcel's leadership, the FCC is going to continue to prioritize this regional collaboration. I think doing so is just going to enhance our efforts by improving our understanding of the global views, positions, and proposals that are out there. And perhaps one final note is that Chairwoman Rosenworcel also has noted that our system of spectrum access today, it has a certain binary quality to it. Either it's licensed or it's unlicensed. Either you have exclusive access or shared access, or federal use or non-federal use. But you know, she's noted in the past that this duality is not the result of physics. It's an intentional set of policy choices. And those policy choices can create scarcity when there are other choices that maybe can create spectrum abundance. So at the FCC, we're also exploring new sharing paradigms that can make it possible to have a whole range of activities in a single spectrum band, all dynamically managed to avoid interference. And this is what we did in the 3.5 gigahertz band, which is available to a mix of government licensed and unlicensed uses, all of it managed by spectrum access databases. So far, I think it's safe to say that it's been an incredible success story. We look forward to exploring opportunities to export this model to other bands and to other parts of the world as well.
Umair, that is really exciting news and super progressive and enormously insightful as well. We're super excited about, first of all, having you here, of course, but also because that Ms. Rosenworcel is now the acting chairwoman, which I think is fantastic news for us in the Wi-Fi industry, but of course in telecom generally. I think we're huge fans of hers. And last thing I want to say, please come back and see us again and pass on our regards and best wishes to Jessica Rosenworcel as well. And thank you so much for coming on.
Thank you. And I'll be sure to do that. Thank you.
Thanks. All right. That was Umair Javed. He is the he is the chief counsel of acting chairwoman of the FCC, Jessica Rosenworcel. So thank you so much. Thanks so much to him. So for our next speaker, we will go to Anatel, of course, and the gentleman's name is Emmanuel Campelo de Souza. He is commissioner and vice president of Anatel, and also one of the chief architects behind the landmark decision that was made last week by Anatel. And Mr. Emmanuel, welcome to the event. We're super happy to have you, sir. I know he's there. I think there he is.
Thank you. Thank you very much for the opportunity.
Great to see you. Thank you so much. And I think, as far as I know, you did have a presentation you wanted to share. Is that correct?
Exactly.
Okay. So you can go ahead and share your screen for that. If
just a moment. Work. Mm-hmm.
Should be a green button, share screen button down at the bottom somewhere. So how does it look? There we go. Yeah, if you can put it in presenter mode, you're good to go. Let's see. Okay, nearly, nearly. And if you put it in presenter mode with the,
oh, okay. Can you see it right now?
We can see it, but it's better if you put it in presentation mode. Do you know that little icon to the bottom?
Okay, yes.
Much better. That's
okay.
It. Good to go. Yes, sir.
All right. So, bom dia a todos. Primeiramente, eu gostaria de agradecer pelo convite e de cumprimentar a todos os presentes e aos que estão nos assistindo. É um prazer estar aqui, falar em nome da Anatel e para apresentar os trabalhos que a agência tem desenvolvido, especialmente após uma decisão histórica tomada pela agência na última semana. Eu peço licença a todos para fazer uma apresentação em português, eu acredito que dessa forma a tradução simultânea, a experiência será melhor para os que nos assistem. Antes de falar propriamente das novidades, acho interessante fazer um pouco do panorama do Wi-Fi no Brasil e no mundo. Como se percebe facilmente, o número de hotspots disponíveis é cada vez maior. Antes escassos, hoje estão presentes em aeroportos, shoppings, cafés e até praças públicas. Mesmo com o crescimento constante das redes móveis, as redes wireless LAN estão cada vez mais presentes. Por diversos motivos, capacidade de lidar com escoamento de tráfego e conexões simultâneas, baixa latência, inexistência de franquias ainda aplicadas ao serviço móvel, indisponibilidade de cobertura móvel e outras. De acordo com as conhecidas projeções publicadas pela Cisco, em um horizonte de 5 anos, espera-se que o número de hotspots no mundo cresça quase 6 vezes, ultrapassando a marca de 500 milhão de redes, enquanto no Brasil espera-se um crescimento superior a 5 vezes. Uma outra aplicação cada vez mais relevante para as redes sem fio é o chamado Wi-Fi Offload, que consiste em solução que permite o uso de cobertura Wi-Fi para escoamento de tráfego móvel. Uma vez que o uso se dá sobre espectro não licenciado e com equipamentos muito mais baratos. Essa é uma solução muito eficaz para lidar, por exemplo, com grandes aglomerações, temporárias ou não, como eventos, shoppings e feiras. De acordo com a Cisco, o offload deverá superar em 2022 uma marca de 100, indicando que a evolução das redes móveis, especialmente do 5G, dependem de massificação das redes locais. Olhando mais especificamente para o mercado brasileiro, a banda larga fixa estima-se que em 2019, 71% dos domicílios possuíam conexão de banda larga fixa, dentre os quais 80% tinham redes Wi-Fi. Todavia, observa-se ainda um grande crescimento no número de clientes, juntamente com uma evolução exponencial do número de acessos por fibra. Esse comportamento se deve, dentre outros motivos, pelo barateamento dos serviços e pela a ausência de rede móvel em algumas regiões, principalmente em áreas mais remotas ou mais carentes. Um fenômeno interessante observado nos últimos anos é o surgimento de provedores regionais de menor porte, que têm buscado ofertar os serviços especialmente em pequenos mercados, onde as prestadoras nacionais não costumam atuar. Esses provedores têm evoluído em parte pela crescente demanda da sociedade, independentemente de classes econômicas e sociais, mas também em função de uma série de desregulamentações feitas pela Anatel e de financiamentos públicos disponibilizados pelo governo. Um dos principais modelos adotados por essas empresas consiste em construir redes de fibra ótica e utilizar hotspots para a disponibilização dos serviços. Para acompanhar a crescente demanda e as novas aplicações e novas padronizações foram publicadas ao longo do tempo, ampliando as capacidades e funcionalidades das soluções. É nessa esteira que se encontra o chamado Wi-Fi 6. Tenho certeza de que todos aqui já conhecem bem as evoluções do Wi-Fi e, por isso, entendo desnecessário apresentar maiores explicações. O que importa destacar é que o novo padrão surge em um momento crucial das telecomunicações do Brasil e no mundo. Além do desenvolvimento do 5G, que, como mostrarei, demandará um grande volume de offload, a pandemia que vivemos hoje, há mais de um ano, trouxe nova perspectiva sobre o uso das redes. O home office e o homeschooling ganharam novas dimensões nesse tempo, o que já tem causado estresse às redes domésticas, e esse cenário possivelmente ainda deverá ganhar maior escala. E por isso, como falei em minha introdução, considero que as decisões sobre o futuro do Wi-Fi de extrema relevância, e mais especificamente no Brasil, histórica. Como todos sabem, duas iniciativas globais relacionadas ao Wi-Fi surgiram. O modelo europeu, que considera o uso de 500 MHz, e o modelo americano, que faz uso de 1.200 MHz. Assim, considerando os resultados da WRC19, o Brasil avaliou a conveniência e os impactos desses dois modelos. Vale destacar que ambos os modelos foram conduzidos a diversos estudos de convivência, o que orientou e permitiu que o Brasil pudesse tomar a decisão com todo o embasamento técnico necessário. Um outro fato levado em conta é que o uso não licenciado de toda a faixa de 6 GHz não impede que seja futuramente utilizada também pelo 5G por meio do chamado 5G Unlicensed, que recentemente foi endereçado no Release 16 do 3GPP. Vale destacar ainda que a faixa de 6 GHz foi debatida na WRC19. Naquela ocasião, decidiu-se ofertar novos estudos para parcela superior de 6.425 a 7.025 GHz, somente na região 1, ao passo que para a região 2, que compreende as Américas, não foram consideradas alterações. Esses direcionamentos já constam, inclusive, da agenda aprovada para a WRC23. Considerando todo esse cenário, o Brasil, então, decidiu rever a resolução número 680/2017, que disciplina as faixas com uso não licenciado permitido. Assim, após todo o trâmite, a alteração foi aprovada em maio de 2020, de modo que a resolução passou a prever a possibilidade de uso não licenciado em toda a faixa de 5.925 a 7.125 GHz. Todavia, é importante ressaltar que a resolução previa ainda o estabelecimento das condições técnicas de operação. Por isso, o uso licenciado ainda não estava liberado naquele momento. Os requisitos técnicos que viabilizaram o uso não licenciado, parcial ou integral da faixa, despertaram diversos debates e foram tratados em eventos, workshops, na consulta pública, resultando em uma grande transparência ao processo. Após todas essas tratativas, a Anatel aprovou, no último dia 25, a versão final do ato. O documento estabelece a possibilidade do uso não licenciado de toda a faixa, de 5.925 a 7.125 GHz, por equipamentos de baixa potência e de baixíssima potência indoor ou outdoor. A versão final foi publicada ontem, o que significa que, desde ontem, o Wi-Fi 6 e o Wi-Fi 6E estão efetivamente livres para serem utilizados no Brasil. O modelo adotado se assemelha bastante ao que foi decidido nos Estados Unidos. Todavia, optou-se por não permitir ainda o uso de equipamentos em potência padrão neste momento, porque o seu uso depende de mecanismos de coordenação automática de frequências que ainda não se encontra plenamente desenvolvido. Com isso, entendo que a decisão tomada permitirá um desenvolvimento ainda mais acelerado nas telecomunicações do Brasil e viabilizará uma infinidade de oportunidades, dentre as quais destaco algumas. Primeiro, o provimento de cobertura é essencial no país, devido à extensão territorial e às desigualdades sociais. Assim, o Wi-Fi surge como uma importante alternativa para o provimento de banda larga, especialmente naquelas áreas onde a implantação de redes móveis não se mostra economicamente viável. Além disso, diversos novos players têm surgido com modelos de negócios e mercados distintos por meio da combinação de fibra ótica e acesso via wireless LAN. Além disso, redes Wi-Fi mais robustas permitirão um melhor escoamento de tráfego, que hoje tem sofrido gargalos em função do aumento das velocidades contratadas da banda larga fixa e também de uma maior demanda residencial, especialmente impactada pela Covid. Também auxiliarão no offload da rede móvel, dando mais condições à evolução do 5G. Por fim, a solução se mostra mais duradoura e levará muito mais tempo para a saturação, o que hoje já ocorre nas faixas de 2,4 GHz e 5 GHz. Cria-se também, inclusive, para o futuro desenvolvimento do Wi-Fi 7, que tem como esboços o uso dos blocos de 320 MHz e a capacidade de emprego das radiofrequências legadas. Para concluir, acho interessante observar os movimentos adotados por reguladores de outros países. Em função dos caminhos adotados na WRC 2019, nota-se um movimento majoritário nas Américas para a adoção do Wi-Fi 6E. Considero que esse fato reforça ainda mais o acerto da decisão tomada pelo Brasil. Assim, eu concluo esta apresentação dizendo que, mais uma vez, a decisão histórica tomada pela Anatel teve por objetivo garantir as melhores condições de desenvolvimento para o país. Tenho certeza de que esse novo modelo impulsionará ainda mais as telecomunicações no Brasil e ajudará a conectar cada vez mais brasileiros com cada vez mais qualidade. Para finalizar, eu gostaria mais uma vez de agradecer pela oportunidade, pelo convite e parabenizar os organizadores e os demais envolvidos neste evento. Estou à disposição de todos, caso também tenham dúvidas ou perguntas, e desejo a todos um bom dia.
Commissioner and Vice President Emmanuel, we're super happy that you're here and thank you so much for taking us through that. What a super impressive and detailed vision for unlicensed bands. I, for one, am super impressed. I want to thank you for that. And I also want to hear if you'll take a couple of questions now. Since our translation appears to be working very well, you can choose yourself if you want to answer in English or in Portuguese. So my first question, my first question to you, sir, is, what do you believe is the most important? I think you touched on this, but just maybe perhaps once again, what do you think is the most important socioeconomic impact of, or will be, the most important socioeconomic impact of 6 gigahertz Wi-Fi for Brazil?
Perfeito. Como eu mencionei em minha apresentação, eu acredito que os impactos são muitos, né? Os impactos positivos. Mas, em minha opinião, acho que o principal talvez seja a capacidade de conectar brasileiros com conexão de altíssima velocidade, especialmente nas áreas em que o serviço móvel não esteja disponível. Alguns provedores regionais, eles têm buscado construir redes de fibra ótica em cidades menores e disponibilizar o serviço por meio de Wi-Fi. Por vezes, alguns moradores chegam a compartilhar a mesma conexão em fibra, em casas distintas por meio do Wi-Fi. Então, assim, esses provedores, eles têm, no Brasil, realizado uma verdadeira revolução digital no interior. Então, isso para um país do tamanho do Brasil e com os gaps sociais que nós possuímos, isso se mostra absolutamente relevante. E acredito que conectar essas áreas com qualidade traz diversos outros benefícios, né? Incentiva o comércio local e a economia, serve como suporte para educação e informação. Então, sem falar na possibilidade de conexões máquina a máquina, M2M, em setores-chave da economia brasileira, como indústria e o agronegócio, né? Ainda existe uma defasagem muito grande de conectividade no agronegócio brasileiro, que é um dos motores da nossa economia. Então, acredito que a tecnologia ela tende a também impulsionar esse setor.
Okay, very good. What do you think that the impact might be, for example, for businesses, and I'm talking also, for example, for service providers, and do you think there will be a lowered cost of connectivity in Brazil as a result of this?
Perfeito. Sim, eu acredito que a solução reduzirá custos. Né? Uma rede Wi-Fi, ela tem um custo bem menor, mesmo se comparado a femtocélulas. É uma solução muito mais barata para coberturas indoor e para lidar com grandes multidões, como shoppings, aeroportos, por exemplo. Um outro benefício é a capacidade de offload, né, que se tem na apresentação. O uso das redes fixas para escoamento de tráfego reduz os custos da rede móvel. E considero também que o novo Wi-Fi ele poderá trazer grandes benefícios às empresas do serviço móvel que possuem menos espectro, por exemplo, até mesmo as MVNOs. Ainda que não seja a mesma coisa, é possível usar o Wi-Fi para complementar a cobertura móvel. Então, isso ampliará a competição e quem ganha é sempre o consumidor. Como eu disse na resposta anterior, o Wi-Fi também é de grande importância para provedores regionais que têm utilizado uma combinação de fibra ótica e Wi-Fi para prover internet de alta capacidade, especialmente onde não há essa cobertura móvel.
Very good. And maybe just one final question about how you view the future of regulation, perhaps the near to medium term future as far as the 6 GHz band is concerned. Do you have any plans, immediate plans, to expand on the rules for 6 GHz, and what might those be? And I think you touched on the subject of the ASC for just a moment during your presentation. I'm thinking specifically about standard power, for example, or other items.
Perfeito. Para responder essa pergunta de forma mais precisa, eu preciso retomar uma parte do que eu mostrei na apresentação. No Brasil, nós temos uma resolução que permite ou veda o uso não licenciado de bandas. E a alteração dessa resolução passa por um processo regulamentar mais complexo. Além disso, a agência estabelece atos contendo os requisitos técnicos de operação. Esse ato pode ser alterado a qualquer momento, por meio de um processo muito mais simples. Então, a resolução ela comporta, hoje, operações não licenciadas em toda a faixa de 5.460 MHz a 8.025 MHz, mas o ato só contém requisitos para a faixa de 5.925 MHz a 7.125 MHz. Isso significa que, a qualquer tempo, de forma mais simplificada, essa faixa pode ser ampliada até o limite previsto na resolução. Assim como também podem ser revistas as condições, permitindo, inclusive, operações em potência padrão com o uso do AFC. Mas acredito que, nesse momento, ainda não tenhamos iniciado o processo para essas revisões. A última decisão ainda é muito recente, foi aprovada quinta-feira passada e publicada ontem. Então, a alteração desse ato possivelmente ocorrerá quando existirem soluções mais maduras no mercado. Eu creio que os próximos passos talvez sejam avaliar operações em potência padrão quando estiver mais viável e melhor avaliar a conveniência com o serviço de transporte inteligente no limite inferior da faixa.
Well, thank you so much for that answer. And first of all, I want to thank you for being here today. I want to congratulate you on the decision. I know you yourself have been very, very deeply committed to this decision and active in this process, which is of course great and wonderful. We thank you for that, sir. Commissioner Emmanuel, please come back and see us again. We hope to do another event, and we'll definitely invite you to speak again. Thank you, sir.
It was a pleasure. Thank you very much for the opportunity.
Thank you so much. Great. All right. That was Commissioner and Vice President of Anatel, Emmanuel Campelo de Souza, and we're super, super happy to have him here. So that was great. Thank you for that. We're going to press on to dive into more of the technological side of the story here, because we've got some great folks coming up right now. Actually, we've got Carlos Cordero. He's wireless CTO of Intel, and I think Carlos is with us and ready to go. Carlos, are you there?
Yes, can you hear me, Klaus?
Yes, very well, sir. Welcome, and great to see you.
Great, thank you, Klaus, for this invitation. I'm still deciding whether I should give this speech in Portuguese or in English.
Wonderful. What a wonderful position to be in.
Exactly. So I will share my screen here, and please let me know if you can see it.
We can see it. You might want to put it on presenter mode.
Yeah, let me do that. All right.
It's coming through perfectly.
Yep. Okay. Mm-hmm. Does it work? Okay.
Perfectly. Go ahead, sir.
All right. Thank you very much for the invitation. It's really a pleasure to be here doing this really momentous time for Brazil. Having been someone that is Brazilian in my heart, and even though I left the country about 20 years ago to pursue my career, and having been involved in this 6 gigahertz journey for the last, 4 or 5 years, it's really personal to me, the fact that Brazil has been able to make this decision and using the right data, and hope that this will be something that's going to be really powerful for the Brazilian economy, for the Brazilian people. And I really wanted to start with a video here that I hope it's going to work. This is from 20 years ago, and as this decision came to fruition in Brazil, I look back 20 years when I was in Brazil, living there and moving the process of moving to US, and I had to see if this works. This is available in YouTube.
I'm going to interrupt you in a second. You need to share it with the sound box ticked. I hope you did that. Then you're good. Did you do that?
Yeah.
You did that. Okay.
Okay. Yeah. Let me see if this works. There you go. I don't know if folks can hear.
Sound is not coming through. If you want to share it again, you can do that. You just have to tick the sound, but you have to unshare and share if you want. It's up to you.
Well, I mean, it's okay. Basically, you can get the point by looking at the screen. This is a video from, an ad from 20 years ago when Intel launched Wi-Fi as part of the Centrino brand. That really started the Wi-Fi, to a large extent, started the Wi-Fi adoption and revolution across the market, because whenever you buy a new Centrino, you would have Wi-Fi with it. And I remember that back in those days, this was Wi-Fi working at 2.4 and some of this 5 gigahertz band. I mean, just a fraction, because those days we didn't have everything. And when I look at it, really is, you know, we have been able, all of us have been able, the industry, the markets, consumers, we have been able to generate what is today a multi-trillion dollars Wi-Fi industry out of 580 megahertz. And, you know, it changes depending on, you know, where you are in the world. But just imagine what we can do now in the future when we have 3 times more spectrum, with this what Brazil can do when now it has 1200 megahertz of spectrum in addition to the 2.45 gigahertz. So it's really powerful what Brazil has done and what other countries in the world are doing. I wanted to start moving, 20 years ago to today, when we have Wi-Fi 6E. I'm not gonna go into a lot of the the background on the regulatory aspect in Brazil, since I know there will be several experts that will be talking about it throughout the day today. But I just wanted to also give another message to our Brazilian friends that there are products that are in the market today, 6E products, and many more products that are down the pipeline. And the message here, and I know this is important, as I talk to my Brazilian colleagues, is you've made this decision. Today, you can have 6 gigahertz products using a license operation in Brazil. Just know that you know there are many products that consumers in Brazil can already start using. Ranging from routers and phones and a wave of laptops that are also available. And some of these products will soon, I'm sure, be available to consumers in Brazil, and Brazilian consumers will be amongst the first ones in the world to be able to make use and, of this spectrum. So this is really exciting when I see this and when I see also correlating with the decision in Brazil. Now, getting into the more technical aspect, the decision in Brazil is not only important for what has been reached for Wi-Fi 6E, but if you just look at Wi-Fi generation from generation, it really has been an evolution that is so important that's really has been able to make Wi-Fi what it is today. When we go back all the way to Wi-Fi 5, which is what we know, some of us that are more techie knows as based on 11AC. It was something that was only developed for the 5 gigahertz band. It had capabilities around the data rates of around 7 gigabits per second. Those are typically theoretical data rates and dating back to June of 2013. When we introduced Wi-Fi 6, and that Wi-Fi 6, if you remember, was introduced in 2019, we offered so many improvements over Wi-Fi 5. 4 times greater scalability, 3 times faster performance, and 75% lower latency. So a great improvement over Wi-Fi 5. Now with Wi-Fi 6E and operation in 6 gigahertz band, we now bring the benefits and the goodness of Wi-Fi 6 into the 6 gigahertz band with many more channels, as we know, 3 times the amount of spectrum, but you know, with 7 160 megahertz channels. But what is really critical, that's why I want us to look into the future. The decision that Anatel made and that other countries around the world are making, they're not only important for Wi-Fi 6 and 6E, but they're essential for the future of Wi-Fi, specifically for Wi-Fi 7, which we expect that will bring around over 7 times performance improvement compared to Wi-Fi 6E. It has one of the features, which is 320 megahertz channels that are only available, that are only possible in the 6 gigahertz band. There are many other features that Wi-Fi 7 brings in addition to 320 megahertz channel support around more spatial streams, something called multi-link operation and other features for lower latency support. And I just wanted to give a glimpse of Wi-Fi 7 by having you take a quick look at this in this slide. On the left-hand side, I'm just highlighting some throughput comparisons of Wi-Fi between Wi-Fi 6 and 7. On the right-hand side, I'm highlighting the improvement in terms of latency over Wi-Fi generations. Starting with the left-hand side, if you look at the color coding, all the bars that are in yellow, these are only possible with Wi-Fi 7, and these are only possible in 6 gigahertz. So for us to be able to reach those data rates that you have in yellow, which are all possible by using 320 megahertz channels, you need 6 gigahertz. And of course, we'll need Wi-Fi 7. So really 6 gigahertz is essential to one of the key features that we expect to come in the Wi-Fi 7 timeframe. When you combine that with what we call multi-link, which is basically the ability to use multiple bands at the same time, that means as a device being able to transmit 2.4 and 6 or 5 and 6 gigahertz, you basically aggregate the capacity of the device and of the network. And that's where the benefits of Y7 that can come up to 7 times the speed of speed of Wi-Fi 6, or more practical data rates in clients that will go up to 8.2 gigabits per second when we consider 2x2 clients. On the right-hand side, latency, you see a continuous decrease in the latency. This is data based on some analysis using a very common traffic workload in enterprise networks. And you see a gradual increase, a decrease from all the way from Wi-Fi 4 to Wi-Fi 6, 6E, and then Wi-Fi 7, where we expect to even have lower latencies. And wanted to say that the future is bright. Coming to Wi-Fi 7, there are many more use cases. I'm not going to go into each one of these, but there are so many other things that are in the future for Wi-Fi, all the way from consumer, the enterprise market, very traditional, industry 4.0, but also so many other uses around the context, whether that's location, sensing, ranging. And so I'm very excited about with the future of Wi-Fi and what's coming up with Wi-Fi 7. And let me conclude and with a call to action. Join us to help shape of the future of Wi-Fi in Brazil. There is a very exciting future that we have now, not only with 6 gigahertz, but what is yet about to come with Wi-Fi 7. And there's so many other usages of Wi-Fi that are coming up down the pipeline. So thank you very much, Klaus. Stop here for any questions.
Carlos, thank you so much for coming on. And actually, I did not know you were Brazilian. I think that is so cool to have you on even in the context of that. But of course, also in the context of what Intel is doing with these things and what the Wi-Fi industry is doing in general, which I think is possibly the fastest ramp up we've ever seen of new standards and getting these new standards, this new technology into the market. Would you agree with that? I mean, this is happening very quickly now. Right?
Yes, Klaus. I think if you look at 11N, 11AC, it was usually a 6 years cadence between generations. What we see happening from Wi-Fi 6 in 2019 to Wi-Fi 7 is that the industry is moving more to a 4 years cadence between generations. Mm-hmm. That has to do various reasons. Both what we see in terms of demand for new users, demand from customers, which is definitely the most important aspect that's driving this, but also making sure that we also always have a competitive technology in the market and always try to drive new users and new experiences to users. So yes, it's more aggressive, but it's something that we see that the market is really a pulling.
Can I just ask you to unshare so we can see a little bit larger?
Of course.
Yeah. A little bit larger view of both of us. I also wanted to just point out perhaps and comment on this, that with Anatel's decision last week, they're actually, Brazil is actually kind of, I suppose, jumping into a 6E market where the first devices and the first access points as well are already out there. I mean, this is also a remarkable situation, I think. Would you agree with that?
This is excellent. I mean, the decision in Anatel has been really timely. These are not the situation where products are still yet to come. In talking to my Brazilian colleagues, they always expressed a question. When we make this decision, do we have products? Are we going to have to allow users to use this band as soon as we make the decision? And so I really wanted to speak to that point in this presentation.
Yeah,
to answer that question and say, hey, products are here.
Yeah, exactly. And that also, I think, lends even more momentum to the global adoption, not for the Americas, of course, but also for the rest of the world, presumably, right?
Absolutely.
Carlos, it's great to have you. Thank you so much for coming on, thank you for doing it in English. It was easier for me to understand. No, I'm just kidding. Thank you so much, sir, and please come back and see us again. Great to have you.
Thank you, Klaus. Pleasure.
Thanks. All right. Our next speaker is Matt McPherson of Cisco. He's wireless CTO, and we're going to do another technology view, and Matt does this brilliantly. Matt, may perhaps unmute yourself and come on and tell us what you've got. It's really good to see you, sir. Thank you for coming on.
Hi, Klaus. It's really, really a privilege to be here. I'm very excited for Brazil, to put it mildly. Mm-hmm. Some of the comments that you and Carlos were just making, I can't tell you how pertinent this is. I think, especially to Brazil, but not just Brazil, as we see 6 gigahertz start to spread through the continent, mm-hmm. As we see 6 gigahertz start to spread across the globe. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think the big advantages of Wi-Fi has been there's been this common spectrum that you could operate in that's available across the globe. And what that does is it makes solutions easier to do. It makes it so that you can focus more on the service as opposed to all the different kinds of spectrum and power and things like that. So to see Brazil really take a leadership role here and to join the leading community in 6 gigahertz is really, really just phenomenal.
I totally agree. Fantastic.
So let me share my screen. All right.
Give me 1 second. Yeah, there should be a green button there.
It's telling me it needs permission, which is interesting.
Oh, no, this is weird. Hang on a second.
There we go. I think it'll work.
No, it says that you can do it. There you go.
There we go. Security just keeps getting better, doesn't it, Klaus?
Exactly.
There you go. All right. Can you see that?
Remote, everything is perfect. You go for it. Thank you.
All right. Again, really, really glad to be here. I really enjoy doing the Wi-Fi Now events. I think there's just a phenomenal audience that's interested specifically in Wi-Fi and the technology that supports it. Always glad to work with Klaus. But you know, as Klaus has these events all over the world, I'm especially excited to see what's going on in Brazil. So I wanted to dive into some of that a little bit. And like Klaus said, I'll get a little bit into the technology, but I wanted to also talk a little bit about the relevance of that technology and what it means. So you know, look, we are already in a wireless first world. Everything that we're doing now in some way or another connects to wireless. You know, I'm sitting in my home, I'm on a laptop that doesn't even have a wired connection. I'm connected to an AP that's over here behind me over on my left shoulder. And that AP is going to another AP over mesh, which is going to a router, which goes into the internet so that I can speak to you guys today. And so what we're seeing is that wireless is being used multiple ways in multiple cases. It's being used for point-to-point connections. It's being used for connecting the end devices. And we're seeing, as Carlos was mentioning, this plethora of new devices that are taking advantage of some of these capabilities. But because it is a wireless first world, and we expect wireless to work wherever we are, whether it's at home or at work, or if we're out and about, or at the airport, or if we're in a hotel, and everywhere in between, we expect wireless to just work. And that means that we have these new levels of expectations on reliability, its ability to scale, our ability to secure it, and in fact, making sure that it's available everywhere and that we can step across stacks, that we can access 5G when it makes sense to access 5G, we can go into Wi-Fi when it makes sense to go into Wi-Fi, and we can leverage these technologies against each other. So it's good to see the progress that's being made in the Wi-Fi 6 specifications and 7, as Carlos had just mentioned, but also in freeing up spectrum so that we can bring these new types of capabilities and applications to life. But it does beg some questions. I mean, 1200 megahertz, that is so much spectrum. I mean, do we really need 1200 megahertz? I mean, can we consume 1200 megahertz? I mean, we're adding more spectrum than what we've had for Wi-Fi in both previous generations, 2.4 and 5. And, you know, look, it's, you know, can we fill it up? I mean, that just sounds like so much spectrum. So let's look at some of those questions. Well, first off, and you may have seen this from the Cisco annual report. If we look on the left here, just a couple of years ago, we had 169 million public hotspots across the globe. And by 2023, which is only 2 years into the future, look at the growth rate here, 628 million hotspots. That's 30% CAGR. Now you say that that's good, but that can cause problems too. And why do I say that? Well, look, if you go to a mall and every store in that mall has a public hotspot that's set up in it, what happens? You know, I was at Mall of America the other day. It's one of the biggest malls on the planet. You go to some of these giant malls that they have over in Singapore and other countries in Europe. And what you see is that you go to get on Wi-Fi and what happens? You see 30, 50 SSIDs. And if you see 30, 50 SSIDs, you're advertising those SSIDs. And those advertisements have to happen at the highest power and at the lowest bit rate. And so you're consuming all this bandwidth because what you're contending for this Wi-Fi. So when we see this type of hotspot growth, what does that mean? That means more interference. And so if we have more interference, how do we mitigate that interference so that we can get a good experience? If you look on the right here, what I'm showing is the average connection speed of mobile devices. So, you know, go back a couple of years, the average mobile connection speed was up to 13 megabits per second. Again, going 2 years into the future, we're expecting three times as much from mobile connectivity. Wi-Fi, a couple of years ago, 30 megabits per second on average, three times as much on average. And this is guest networks. This is where there's high density. This is where we're doing a lot of type of connectivity. We get into the office, we get into the home, and of course these speeds even go higher. And how many times when you're at home have you gone to connect and you look at the SSIDs and you see all of your neighbors because Wi-Fi is going further and it's penetrating out further. And guess what? All those neighbors to you are a rogue, more interference. So we have to deal with this additional interference. We have to deal with this additional traffic. And again, if we look at the density, you know, what's the other, you know, great success of Wi-Fi is that everybody's getting on. And we're seeing this incredible growth, not only in devices. If you look at the billions of devices out there, it's growing at about 10% CAGR. If you look at the real growth, it's really in machine to machine. It's really in IoT. And in fact, IoT is growing at about 20%. And I believe that we haven't even turned the J curve on IoT yet. As we go to smart home, smart buildings, smart airports, smart hotels, smart office, every time someone says smart, think lots and lots of IoT devices. Think lots and lots of tags for asset tracking. Think about new capabilities that we have with robot and automation. These things are all coming down the pike. And what happens when you increase density? One of the areas where Cisco's done a lot of research is, in fact, lecture halls at universities. And what do you have? You have a bunch of students sitting close together. Some of these lecture halls can be hundreds, if not 1,000 students. And guess what? Everybody is talking into that Wi-Fi and they're all contending for that resource. And look, they have to because it's part of the education experience. So we're getting this additional density. So this is why. If we have these higher expectations of our connectivity, if we have these higher expectations of Wi-Fi, then what do we need to do? We need to address that interference domain, and we need to address the throughput requirements of the next generation. You know, I use this, this slide I've condensed a little bit, Klaus, but I use this first at Wi-Fi Now. I showed this in a couple of events ago. But this is so significant, I just wanted to make sure everybody grasp it, because if, for example, you know, it wasn't that long ago where we were saying, hey, look, 2.4 is completely congested. You really need to go into 5 gigahertz. And you can see in 5 gigahertz that the typical deployment would normally be using 20 megahertz, maybe 40 megahertz channels. I mean, you can push 80, you can push 160. It's great for doing demonstrations and whatnot. But when you talk about these high density environments, what you have to do is you have to separate the spectrum out between the different APs so they're not interfering with each other. And what happens is that you start to build for the throughput of the overall network, which means what? Which means 20, 40 megahertz channels. So what that does is that limits your ability to get higher throughput. It limits your ability to get higher density. And you have to do that because what are you doing? You're trying to control your interference domain. But now look on the right in 6 gigahertz and look what opens up. Now we got, you know, you can do 20, you can do 40. I think 20 will actually become rare. I think we'll see some 40. I think 80 megahertz will be the new 20. And in many cases, you'll even do 160 and above megahertz. This means just in the spectrum, we're isolating the APs and rogues from one another so that we can get that more reliable wireless experience. We can get on the wireless faster and off again because we can transmit the data, the bearer channel, much faster, 2, 4, 20 times faster using the new protocols and the new spectrum. And this is what's enabling. This is what's enabling that next generation. This is what's enabling the future. What does this mean? I mean, what does this mean? I'm just gonna, you know, Carlos was saying, you know, good grief, there's a lot of use cases out there. I'm just gonna show a couple of use cases, you know, hopefully to bring some of this messaging home. I mean, we look at healthcare. Do you realize that digital healthcare is growing at 30% a year? 30% a year. That is currently shown to be a $504 billion market, digital healthcare. And if you look on the right, the optimal experience in these healthcare locations, whether it be a clinic or it be a hospital, they're looking for higher densities. And what we're seeing in the high dense environments for guests and patients and staff and IoT devices, all this medical equipment, that's growing at nearly 30%. So we see these huge capabilities that are coming down. And if you look at the center of this slide, what does it actually mean? Well, what about reading an MRI? What about having a remote doctor? What about doing diagnosis, you know, from specialists that look at these things all day to make sure that they catch everything that's going on with that patient to make the best diagnosis? You know, a 30 HD MRI image is about 2 gig per image. I mean, think about how long it would take a doctor or someone to look at an MRI, just looking at a small snapshot. And then we get Wi-Fi 6E. What are we? We're 20 times faster than what we've been doing in previous generations, which means that we can increase productivity. We can make doctors available to more patients. And that's what we're doing, right? With this automation and this additional capability and additional density, we're providing better healthcare to more people and using the assets that we have more efficiently. What about the workspace? What about multi-tenant type implementations? Well, collaboration, that's what we're doing right now. $20 billion market, 10% CAGR as it continues to go. And I actually think that this is a really low estimate on what we mean by digital collaboration, because I think digital collaboration went from making voice calls, people picking up their cell phone and making a call, to these much richer environments like what we're doing now, which continues to grow as a market, to actually these immersive environments where we start to get into things like VR and AR. And then on the right, you can see this, I mean, everything's going into the cloud. This cloud productivity, being able to offer services wherever you are, being able to do that with a good quality of service, being able to do that with security, 42% growth as we optimize these cloud-based business applications. So the world's changing. The world's changing for the better. And the world needs these new swaths of large pieces of spectrum. And we continue. We look at education. Education is exploding when it comes to applying digital learning and capabilities. On the left, you see digital campus. 41% of students on campus have 3 or more devices. So there we go. We're seeing that density really grow. You put several hundred students in a lecture hall, they're not connecting one device, they're connecting 3 or more devices. Density, need more spectrum, need to protect for interference. Digital learning, 75% of teachers believe that digital learning will replace books. Books, it's hard to think that, but books are going away. Why? Because you can produce this immersive experience. It's one thing to look at a three-dimensional drawing in upper education when you're doing calculus. It's another thing to be able to see it in 3D and rotate it and see what that multi-integration is doing and how to understand that math. It's another thing to be immersed into what you see here, where they're looking at the dissection of a graphical frog. And I'm sure that we're all going to miss, you know, cutting into real frogs and that old familiar smell that we had when we all did that when we were in elementary school. But here we can see that we can really bring these things to life and better engage the students, which we see on the right. This real-time engagement, 77% say that digital technologies help improve students' grades. And so these types of applications, they just expect this next level of connectivity. In fact, on the bottom here, we're showing AR, VR. I'm gonna get into this a little bit more because I think that AR, VR is just going to explode. In the past, there's been a couple of bottlenecks really blocking augmented reality from happening. One bottleneck was the speed of the network itself. But the other bottleneck was actually the speed, the ability, the processing power that it took to do AR and VR. And what's happening is as silicon improvements continue to double year on year and compute, just like Carlos was mentioning earlier, the capabilities that Intel is building into their new chipsets means that AR, VR from a computational standpoint is a reality. And that's what I'm showing here. AR, VR is real. We see these glasses that you can buy today. Epson has glasses, Facebook has glasses. We know that Apple has announced at their events, they've optimized silicon specifically for AR. They did a really cool demo where you would look through an iPad, it was like a window, and they created a city on a tabletop. And so then they could move around that city and they could see the traffic patterns and things like that. This is a complete difference and how we would do some of these optimizations and these capabilities before. You see here that there's just a plethora of companies that is getting into this space, right from the chipset to the device. And of course, Cisco, from a network capability in covering some of these types of capabilities. And if you look at this chart came out actually a couple of years ago, but I thought it was interesting because it's directly applicable today. If you look at early level VR, you look at entry level VR, even early VR is expecting 25 megabits per second. And that's only a 1K video. But as we start to get to advanced VR, 4K, if we start to get to the point where it's retina resolution, which is getting up there in 5K and north of that, what that means is that to be completely immersed in a overlaid reality that services you by making you completely aware of your surroundings, these types of capabilities you can see now start requiring 400 megabits, extreme VR, a gigabit to 2.3 gigabits of bandwidth going through the network. So do we need this spectrum? Yeah, we do need the spectrum because this is right around the corner. You know, I wanted to, you know, Klaus, I can't help myself, right? I have to talk about open roaming in every presentation I ever do.
You're very welcome to do that, sir. Please go ahead.
But, you know, one of the things that I wanted to point out is we're doing lots and lots of open roaming trials. You know, we see incredible interesting in this space. How do you do this automatic onboarding? How do you make it seamless? How do you make it secure? How do you make it smart? And every place that we're doing this, we are seeing 3 to 4 times the attach rates into the network. So 3 to 4 times the attach rates, 3 to 4 times the traffic. So not only are the applications more hungry, not only are the applications going in the cloud, not only are the new applications using things like VR, but the number of people connecting to your network with technologies like open roaming are gonna be as much as 4 times that attach than you had before. That drives density, that drives throughput, all these things that we've been talking about. Finally, I wanted to say, look, there's this intentional, I'll call it intentional coexistence that's looking us right in the face. As we open up 6 gigahertz, and I know this is a somewhat complex chart, but look at that, those yellow bars. I'm just looking at the unlicensed spectrum. I'm also showing here what's happening in locally licensed and shared spectrum and licensed spectrum. But let's just focus on the unlicensed spectrum bar for a second. We see Wi-Fi 6 came in. We see it, 6 gigahertz start to become available. We start to see devices coming available and in fact, a plethora of devices mainstreaming even by the end of this year. And then what happens? NRU. What's NRU? NRU is 5 gigahertz going into unlicensed spectrum. So not only are we going to see all these Wi-Fi devices coming into 6 gigahertz, now we're going to see NRU coming into 6 gigahertz too. So all these new applications, all these new services, and now we're going to have multiple stacks in there. So do we need 1200 megahertz? Good grief, we sure do, because all this is coming at that particular space. So be ready for convergence, be ready for coexistence, because again, this is right around the corner. And then I'm gonna close to wrap up here. You know, I just wanted to mention for a second, a lot of people don't know some of the proposals that are going into the FCC in the US and other countries on client-to-client connectivity using low power. 6 gigahertz has different power requirements depending on what you're doing. And what's proposed now is this, what's known as client-to-client. And that's what I'm showing in this chart. So, you know, think about your watch, think about smart wearables. In this case, what I'm showing is a VR headset connecting to your phone, and your phone having multiple radios that can go over 6E, it can go over 5G, it can do that in various spectrum ranges to get to that service so that you can provide these new types of capabilities and services. And this C2C connectivity can use up to 320 megahertz of spectrum, right? Now it's low power, we're trying to keep that under control so it doesn't interfere with everything around it. But you can imagine now 320 megahertz of spectrum between the device and then using 6E again to get over to your backhaul, to get to your service, that is consuming a lot of spectrum. So do we need 1200 megahertz of spectrum? The answer is couldn't be more absolutely and positively yes. So just to conclude, look, 6 gigahertz is synonymous with innovation. 6 gigahertz will drive convergence. What that means is connected all the time, everywhere, using multiple stacks for the next generation of innovation and services. 6E will improve reliability and your overall experience. You can count on wireless today, but in the future, it will be more resilient than we've ever seen before. And 6 gigahertz, you know, you can read the reports. I thought about putting some of the numbers in here, but I think you've all read it. The significance and economic impact with these new types of applications and services is frankly huge. So with that, Klaus, you know, I'll wrap up, and I think you can tell I'm pretty excited about this because you can see a little bit of gray in my beard. You know, I'm getting a little bit older, and you know, as far as I'm concerned, this stuff can't move fast enough because I'm ready for those new, you know, AR glasses that's telling me everything about my environment. So it's just not for our kids. You know, I want to experience it too.
I'm getting a set as soon as we get them as well. I can promise you that. Great presentation, Matt. Thank you so much. I just want to spend 1 minute with you on something that I always thought was brilliant that you said. I think this is a couple of years ago at a Wi-Fi Now event. I think the first time I heard it was in Berlin. And you mentioned this idea of deterministic services with Wi-Fi, which is something new with Wi-Fi 6. And I would argue even more prevalent or will be more prevalent with 6E. And by deterministic, and you can please elaborate on this, but I understand it to mean that we finally have Wi-Fi services now that will not deteriorate when you put more devices on the network. It will actually perform exceedingly well, even with a lot of high density and so forth. This is the way the standard has been created. But this, of course, is super, super important in the context of what's going on with 6E all over the world. And please comment on that, if you will, Matt.
And you know, Klaus, you know, I've been a big advocate of this because what's happening is there's this whole new world of applications and services that are very latency dependent. Call it mission critical. or call it IoT. I mean, think industrial IoT, moving a robot or a robot arm to manufacture a car. Think about a robot running around a big warehouse, pulling things off the shelf. And what has to happen there is that for safety reasons, and these things are buzzing around, they can be buzzing around the warehouse hitting, 30, 40 miles an hour, right? And so what you're doing is you're optimizing these types of experiences. Think about healthcare. Do you need determinism there? Well, yeah, you know what? If I'm laying in a bed and I got a heart monitor over here and it's talking to the nurse's station, do I want determinism? I think I do. Right. And so what happens is that is there's this whole new set of applications and services that are dependent on us to be able to control that delay, that jitter, and make it very low. I talked about AR VR. What does AR VR need so you don't get sick as you're looking around? You need 10 millisecond delay. That means we have to use local compute. We need to use MEC. That means we have to have a very fast network connection, and we have to have very fast processing. So this is the next generation. That market for deterministic applications and services is as big or bigger than the market that we have today. You know, in human time, humans are slow. And I don't, that's take that with a grain of salt, but in compute time, humans are slow. But when you start getting into these robots and robot arms and automation and all these other things, those things can compute very fast. The delay characteristics that you need to support those types of capabilities are much faster. That's what we're moving into.
Matt, great vision on what Wi-Fi 6E is all about, what 6 gigahertz is all about. And we have to remember this is now the vision that, of course, Brazil, as of last week, is now a part of. We have to remind ourselves of that, which is, of course, really, really great news, as are a number of other countries, a growing number of countries right across the world. Matt, thank you so much for coming on. We want you to come back as much as you possibly can, because you always inspire us. I want to thank you. Thanks a lot.
Thanks, Klaus. And congratulations to Brazil. You know, I couldn't be happier.
Yeah, me too. Fantastic. All right, we're going to press on to our next speaker. And I'm delighted to say that for the first time at one of our events, at least, we have a representative from Amazon with us. And we're super happy to introduce Ravi Ichapurapu. He is senior wireless engineer at Amazon. Ravi, are you with us? I can see you're there. There he is. Ravi, welcome.
Hey, Klaus. Thank you. Thank you for setting this up. We're really excited. The 6 gigahertz momentum is really exciting. And congratulations to Brazil. This is really great news. We are really excited about this. Let me pull up my slides and we can...
Great. We're having a little bit of difficulty switching to your view. Now we can see you now. Ravi, are you there?
Okay. Yes, I'm here.
I'm just going to see if the speaker view actually.
So,
go ahead.
Yeah, so it's having me, do the same thing I did to Matt. So let me quickly try to get this to share my screen.
Sure.
Just give me a second.
Yeah, no problems. You're most welcome. So, but as I understand it, by the way, my producer tells me that all the translations are working well. We want to thank our translators. As I said, this is the first time we're doing this, so we're happy about that. And not that it's rocket science, but it sometimes is for us. So thank you for that. And I think Ravi, did he just pop off for a moment there? Okay, we're going to give him the chance to come back on. And by the way, let me just elaborate while we're waiting for Ravi to come back. We have also tomorrow, so we decided to split this program into two pieces because we thought it would be too long for a single day. So tomorrow we will have on the program Alan Norman of Facebook, and we have Anatel coming back. We'll have the GSMA here. I think Ravi is back, or he's trying to. He is. I'm just going to let him set up. Yes. And we'll also have IDC Latin America. Oi is here to speak to us, as well as Comscope. And Alex Jusius is the CEO of Associação Neo, which is the Association of ISPs in Brazil. He's coming also to see us tomorrow. Scott Imhoff is with Cambium Networks. And finally, Katie Pierozzi is with Mamba Wi-Fi. So I was just filling out some space here. Ravi, please please go ahead and present while you were off there for a second. By all means, go ahead.
Okay, just wanted to check now you can share, you can see my share.
Yeah, you're good. Everything is completely clear.
All right. Okay, great. Thanks, Klaus. Sorry about that.
No,
So basically, you know, again, I'm going to start, you know, with some of the questions that Matt raised, very relevant. You know, we have a slightly different perspective being, you know, Amazon. We are in a position where we are a consumer of Wi-Fi and we also make products with Wi-Fi. So, you know, this question of why, you know, why do we need the unlicensed 6 GHz band? Why 1200 megahertz of spectrum, right? So we did this beta program where we tried to look at channel utilization in the US across different types of homes, different type of settings. So we looked at single family homes, apartments. We tried to look at urban, semi-urban, rural settings. And what we were trying to do is we were trying to see how many networks we would see in the 5 GHz band. And you know, where this, which channels they were using, and in a given home, how many networks you see, right? All of this is very relevant because even though we have all of these newer Wi-Fi standards, if you have a lot of interference and congestion, your performance is going to be capped in a specific way, right? So what I have here on my first slide, the first plot to the left is showing you where we saw, you know, 5 GHz channel utilization, right? Which specific channel? So as you can see here, what we found is that maybe not surprising, but it is quite interesting that 5 GHz, 80 megahertz channels typically sit either in uni one or uni three, right? And this is because of DFS and, you know, the channels in between requiring you to do more things to be, you know, allowed to operate there. So we saw that, you know, over 90% of 5G 80 megahertz channels sit in just these two bands, right? And what we have in the second plot is also quite interesting. What this is showing is if you look at, you know, percent of homes and how many, you know, SSIDs they see, basically this is neighbors networks and other networks that you see. And you can see that, you know, when you want to cover like a decent number of homes because you're trying to build a product or a service that works well for a lot of customers, you want to, you know, build something that works for over say 95% of people, right? And you can see that there's lots of networks that you can see, like you can see upwards of 10 networks, right? That's significant. And what this means is these networks may not be all, you know, using the air at the same time, but as they come on, this causes, you know, delays and latency for your own packets, right? So what we're showing in the third plot is we try to capture the effect of interference on packet latency, right? And this is like a controlled setting where we try to mimic, you know, networks coming on and off, both on your channel and on, you know, adjacent channels. And we were trying to see how that impacts latency. So you can see that latency, you know, can be quite spread out. And what this kind of, you know, comes back to is quality of service and things that, you know, Matt already mentioned about, you know, if you want to build something that's mission critical, you can't have like this huge spread in latency. Right, and I'm going to go into some of the applications next and why, you know, this matters for some of them, but this is usually what happens, right? So if you have these congested channels that you have to operate in, you have latency and other, you know, degradation in network performance, which, you know, is not a great customer experience, right? Now, so the 6 GHz spectrum, you know, will allow us to get multi-gigabits of throughput, low latency. It's a huge network capacity boost. And, you know, this basically in conjunction with Wi-Fi 6, it basically turbocharges the performance, right, that we can expect. And a lot of this is also tied to the fact that you don't have interference from legacy clients because they're not allowed on, you know, to use these channels. And also basically, you have like much more spectrum to choose, right? So if you have all these networks around you, it's in some way, you know, to your advantage to kind of isolate them, like Matt was talking about, and try to give each of these networks their own lane, right, in some way. So basically the 1200 megahertz opens up, you know, 7 160 megahertz channels compared to the 2 we would get in 5 gigahertz. It would give us 14 channels of 80 megahertz bandwidth compared to the 6 we get in 5 gig. Now, once you have the spectrum and you can get this multi gigabits of throughput, you can get low latency, what can we do with this, right? And I'm trying to basically look at a few different buckets of applications that are very interesting. So the first bucket is infrastructure, right? So we talked about, you know, fulfillment centers, warehouses, lots of data flowing through. We're fulfilling lots of orders every minute. There's, you know, robots that are trying to, you know, do some of this work. All of these devices are, you know, using a lot of data, and you can't necessarily have wires running to a lot of these, you know, kind of stations, right? So having reliable wireless goes a long way in, you know, these kind of applications. Industrial automation, again, as the latency goes down and things become more real time, what you can do with automation, you know, is very interesting. Then you have these mesh backhaul for point-to-point and point-to-multipoint. These are like backhaul networks. These are interesting for infrastructure users, again, for like, you know, factory floor, stuff like that. Also for small carriers and providers who are trying to, you know, service a specific area. I think this is very relevant in developing countries. And then you have these very interesting applications with high-speed tethering and data transfers. You can think of like a movie in a minute, right? You walk into this airport, you check in, you tap your phone, you download a movie that you can go watch on the plane. So that's another interesting area. The next bucket is consumer electronics. Streaming is really big, right? We've already gone to 4K and, you know, high dynamic range. We're looking at high frame rate. 8K is coming. You know, we have like, you know, sporting events and other things where, you know, 8K at this high dynamic range is going to need a lot of throughput. AR and VR, you know, is like a very good application for this. Basically needs a lot of throughput, low latency for a good experience. Mobile phone applications, you know, like the demo that Matt mentioned that Apple did, also needs a lot of data, low latency. Home mesh networks, this is also, you know, mesh networking is becoming more and more mainstream. People want coverage around the home. They want to be able to, you know, do their, you know, work or, you know, play from anywhere, and having good, reliable, you know, coverage and throughput through the home becomes more essential. Cloud direct gaming is another one. This is gaining more traction. This is like console-free gaming where you can use your phone or any device to, you know, play console, you know, class games. Again, requires you to stream these games from cloud, high latency, high throughput, low latency kind of applications. The third bucket I want to talk about is automotive. Automotive, I think, is evolving really fast, and lots of changes. You know, basically, we have a lot of in-vehicle entertainment, infotainment kind of applications. We have all these sensors, cameras, and other things that are going into cars to support features for driver augmentation, self-driving. You have, you know, wireless CarPlay, Android Auto as interfaces to the car. Again, need low latency to get a good experience. And vehicle to X is becoming something, you know, that is gaining popularity. Lots of standards are trying to do vehicle to X, but, you know, nothing like unlicensed spectrum to kick off, you know, more innovation. The fourth category is, you know, very relevant given, you know, the pandemic and what we're seeing, you know, in the last year. Remote healthcare, monitoring, learning, these are all becoming very essential and, you know, basically changing how things, you know, are done in a lot of, you know, different areas. So having more spectrum improves our ability to do things like localization, which is trying to figure out, you know, where people are so you can save energy by turning off lights when they're not in a specific room. Wireless sensing is again a very interesting area that's gaining a lot of traction. Being able to detect presence, being able to detect fall, trying to do some vital monitoring. Wi-Fi devices are everywhere, and if you can do this using existing devices, it basically, you know, brings the cost of, you know, long-term monitoring down significantly. Remote work and learning, streaming, telepresence, four or five people at home all trying to, you know, attend class, you know, join calls for work, you know, is really straining networks, and we need to figure out ways to do this better. And the last category is telemedicine, again, growing very fast. It's basically enabling us to give care to people who are isolated or in rural areas. So very interesting. So, I mean, in terms of summarizing, lots of interesting applications. We're really excited about, you know, what the 6 GHz spectrum can do. Wi-Fi 6E is building on this, and in our view, it's like an essential and a perfect companion to other things like 5G, you know, satellite broadband and fiber and other things, which will allow us to enable these applications, especially in indoor, residential, and industrial settings. So, Wi-Fi, you know, 6E is not something that's a few years down the line. It's here. You know, we see a lot of traction. You know, Carlos shared this as well. I tried to capture a few of them here. We're seeing access points come out. We're seeing phones. We're seeing, you know, desktops or laptops. We're seeing silicon availability from multiple vendors. And now that, you know, unlicensed spectrum is being approved in a lot of these countries. You know, FCC did this for the US, Brazil's doing this now. You know, we're from, as a product company, we're really excited to build devices and services that delight customers, right, based on these technologies. And, you know, I just want to say, you know, we would like to thank FCC for their leadership and vision. You know, they've unlicensed the 6 GHz spectrum first, and, you know, they've really paved the way for these products and silicon. And, you know, relevance of 6 GHz spectrum for Brazil, right? So we would like to congratulate and commend, you know, Anatel's board of directors. It was unanimously approved, all 1200 megahertz. We think this puts Brazil in the list of front runners who have unlicensed spectrum and really opens up interesting applications that we kind of covered. You know, we're really excited to work on devices and services that will use this spectrum to solve customer problems and in general improve their interactions with technology as technology becomes, you know, more and more integral to, you know, daily life. And all of this also has a lot of economic value. You know, basically it's expected to, you know, provide over $112 billion in, you know, contribution to the GDP. I'm sure my colleagues at DSA will talk about this more, but just to say that there's significant economic impact when you do something like this. I want to end with a quote that Dave Limb, our senior VP, you know, put in an op-ed. It goes, you know, whether it is for educational work or home purposes, it's clear that Wi-Fi and wireless connectivity are essential to our daily lives. For 20 years, access to unlicensed Wi-Fi spectrum has driven an incredible amount of innovation for both consumers and businesses alike. And because of this, Amazon strongly supports these efforts to expand access to unlicensed spectrum and create new opportunities for Wi-Fi.
Ravi, thank you so much for that. And it's great to have you. And as I said, the first time we've had an Amazon person, one of our events, and I was just going to say, where have you guys been? We really want you here because this is excellent input. And thank you so much. Can you, is there anything perhaps you want to say? I don't know if you can. We know, of course, Amazon from lots of activities and so on. And as far as Wi-Fi is concerned, the Eero home mesh network or router and system is outstanding, one of the first on the market originally. And we, of course, know Alexa and so on. Are there any specific product areas that you guys are zooming in on these days just with a view to, of course, making the best use of the 6E spectrum that is now available, not just in the US, of course, but now also in Brazil? Can you comment on any of that?
Yeah, so, I mean, we're really excited, right? The 6 GHz spectrum, I think, is going to really revolutionize a lot of the connectivity, both in terms of, you know, as consumers and for customers, right? We're looking at a whole, you know, swath of these applications. I try to highlight some of those on my slides where Amazon has, you know, has looked at, and we are continuing to, you know, look at. At this point, we don't have any, you know, product or other kind of things we can share, but we'll come back soon once we have things to share. And, you know, this is really exciting times. I've been looking at Wi-Fi for a long time, and I feel 6 GHz spectrum is really one large step, and I feel it's going to drive a lot of innovation. A lot of really cool devices and services, I think, will come up in the next few years.
I so agree with you, and I thank you for saying that. And as said, we'll definitely want to, you know, to hear what you guys have coming up, because this is an exciting space, and there's so much opportunity. So, Ravi, thank you so much for that. Thank you also for zooming in, of course, as we shared on this event on the Brazilian situation, which is as of last week, fantastic as far as 6E is concerned. So thank you so much, sir. Please come back and see us again.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for this opportunity, and congratulations again to Brazil. Really, really, you know, exciting times.
Definitely agree. Thank you, Ravi. See you next time.
Right. See you. Thanks.
Okay, our next speaker, and actually I should say, actually before we get going with this next section and last section for today, is about regulation, spectrum regulation, and coexistence. And we're going to do some of it today. And we're going to continue tomorrow with more speakers on the topic of spectrum regulation. So we're super, super honored, actually, because we have with us today a lady by the name of Pamela Gidi. She is Vice Minister of Telecommunications for the Republic of Chile. And we're super, super happy that you're here. I think she's should be on. Oh, there she is. Ms. Pamela, thank you so much for coming on, and a huge welcome to you. And my Spanish is awful, so I hope you're not going to do this in Spanish. Ms. Pamela, are you there? I can see you, but I don't hear anything. Just a second. Oh, there she is. And I'm going to ask. Ms. Pamela, can you hear us?
Yes, I can, Adam.
Ah, there you are. Okay, very good. Thank you for joining us, and welcome to the event. Nice to see you.
I'm trying to project the presentation that I have.
Ah, right. Okay, so you're trying to share it, right? So if you go to the green button, it should be possible. Yep, that looks like you're on the right track there. Yes, yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you very much.
And if you put it on, presenter mode, can you do that for us?
There.
That's it. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Okay.
And I think we can also hear you, so you're good to go.
Yeah.
No, it was good. It was fine just before. You were fine. You were fine. If you go to the presenter mode, Pamela.
Okay. Well.
That's it. That's the one. Yeah.
Okay.
There, it's perfect. We hear you and we see everything.
Okay. Perfect. Well, we have seen a lot about potential applications of 6 GHz and also the technical side. So I'm gonna talk today more of how the 6 GHz fits into the whole picture of a country strategy from the regulatory side, and how this is a piece of the puzzle of our main goal to connect industry and households with the higher connectivity possible. So we started in 2018, trying to basically foster the fiber optic spectrum. We had at least 80 municipalities, communes of out of 346 that had none fiber optic. and many others have only one company with the consequences for legal coverage and bad service or high price. Chile has a very difficult geography. It's very thin and long as you see it. And so we decided also we had, we need to improve this. We make the goal of double fiber optic in Chile in our 4 years of government. We have over 3,000 of rural BTS with very weak or non-backhaul, having really a big side of a population that lives in either rural areas or low income areas with very low level of connectivity, showing up a high and painful disparity in connectivity standards for citizens that live in big areas, city areas or wealthy areas. Just to give an example how slow the FTTH deployment was, we have 100 communes with less than 4% of FTTH penetration. We have 200 out of these 346 with less than 7% penetration. And in worldwide, we have 18%, which obviously there's a big difference there, but it's still 18% was very low to the OECD countries we'd like to compare with. Now, after 3 years, we are reaching 36% and growing, and we achieved this with a matrix of projects that were looking and to double the kilometers of fiber optics in these 4 years. How we did this? To start with the biggest central subsidies in the history of Chile in these 3 years, we built did the tender process for three backbones of dark fiber to cover close to 200 communes out of 346. These are neutral access with fixed price ceilings, so making sure we have a good price for rural low income households or companies. Interconnection with other network, and specifically with regional subsidies. We work with all the local governments of all Chile in last mile projects that will be connected to this main backbone. And at Soctel, we provide all the technical draft projects, engineering projects, the regions approve, and they transfer the funds to us, and we do the tender process to go and companies compete for funds. We also have just done the 5G contest, successful contest that at least will cover 90% of the population in 3 years, with also having equal territory rights. We're covering all the regional capitals, the provincial capitals around Chile, plus almost 400 of localities that are rural areas that have none or little internet connectivity. So after 3 years, we can say that we're gonna cover 343 out of 346 communes. We're gonna start the deployment of 5G mobile access that will cover 90% of the people, and therefore the houses and the offices and industry in all the country will have fiber service to them, even in rural places. So the question comes, so what is the purpose of having gigabyte internet connection at home or in the office with fiber to their places if we can't use this inside those buildings, either homes or offices? And this is why we enable 6 GHz for indoor Wi-Fi use. 6 GHz is more than a new step for Wi-Fi. More channels available for indoor Wi-Fi means more concurrent users and more bandwidth. Chilean households and offices and households have at least 14 devices connected in average. So we need the power of 6 GHz, but also this goes into the purpose and goal to have fast and reliable internet in a fixed and mobile environment And in this puzzle, Wi-Fi 6 GHz helps to deliver the last meter broadband. 6 GHz current spectrum decision is not for the short term, is for a 10 or more years scope for making FTTH ecosystem stronger with enough spectrum for household and workplace. Thank you.
Thank you so much for elaborating on that. And also, if I can ask you perhaps to unshare, I know you have to go really quickly because we also kept you, we kept you too long because there was a delay. But Ms. Pamela, thank you so much for coming. And we want to, we will have other events and we will ask you to come back. And it's an honor to have you, Ms. Yeah. And do you have no time for any questions? I wanted to congratulate you, first of all, making the decision, because you were one of the first to make this decision on 6 GHz in the Americas, correct? I mean, following the FCC.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, okay. Thank you very much. Okay, that was Ms. Pamela Gidi. She's Vice Minister of Telecommunications at Chile of the Republic of Chile. Chile, of course, one of the first countries to make the decision on releasing the full 6 GHz band that happened some months ago. So we're super happy to have her here. Now, for our next speaker, I would like to welcome Alex Reutblatt. Alex is VP of Regulatory Affairs at the Wi-Fi Alliance, and we work very closely with the Wi-Fi Alliance, and we're super happy to have you, Alex. And I think he's ready to go. I can see him with a beautiful background up there. Alex, are you there?
Yes, I am, and hopefully you can hear me.
Yep, definitely. A beautiful background of Washington, D.C. In full bloom with the cherry blossoms and all of that. So that's where you are, I'm assuming, in Washington, D.C., right?
That you're right. and Klaus, thank you for having me. As always, an excellent lineup for Wi-Fi Now. You do an amazing job. I'm immersed in this topic, and yet I learn every time I participate in your events. So
that is such a huge compliment coming from you, sir. So thank you very much for that. Do you have a presentation for us, Alex? I think you do.
Yes, yes, I do. And I'm going to try to put it up. Can you see it?
Yes, we can see it. So we just need to, that's it. That's
yeah, cool. I'm going.
You're good to go.
Okay.
Yeah, works.
Right. So what I'm going to do is hopefully complement your previous presenters with the discussing the regulatory landscape of Wi-Fi 6, looking not just at Latin America or Brazil, but actually at the whole world and how different countries are moving forward on making the 6 GHz available. And of course, Wi-Fi 6E is the technology that is destined to operate in this band, in the 6 GHz band. And so it's practically synonymous with the 6 GHz. So Wi-Fi 6E is being enabled by regulators around the world. And we certainly are grateful for Brazil. I'll get into that in my presentation later on. But other regulators as well are moving forward. So with that, just a quick overview of who is Wi-Fi Alliance. So we are a network of over 850 companies from around the world that are focused on enabling the Wi-Fi technology and the Wi-Fi ecosystem, promoting it, and of course, the advocating for a regulatory framework to support this ecosystem, which is obviously becoming quite important. So for today, my plan is to just quickly overview the Wi-Fi spectrum needs. I know previous speakers touched on this topic, but I'll try to offer a bit different perspective and then take a look at what is the Wi-Fi 6E regulatory framework as it's being applied by regulators around the world. And then discuss the 6 GHz spectrum issues that we're encountering. So with that, let's proceed. So Wi-Fi spectrum needs. So Matt and Ravi and others have mentioned already, the demand for Wi-Fi continues to grow and will grow even faster with 5G rollout. Keep in mind that the projections are that the 5G data, the volume of data will grow by probably 10 times from the 4G. That's the projections. And then if you keep also take into account the fact that most of that data is offloaded onto Wi-Fi, you can imagine how much data Wi-Fi will be expected to carry with the introduction of 5G technology. And of course, this additional capacity of spectrum is sorely needed to support multiple Wi-Fi devices that are being introduced. I think Matt mentioned that college students have 3 devices now. I think they have quite more. As a parent of a college student, I can tell you they're loaded up with everything from watches and bracelets and laptops and phones. So the number of devices just continues to grow, but then of course the connection speeds are also growing and the volume of data continues to go up. So all this needs spectrum capacity and countries are taking steps. It's very encouraging to see regulators making the 6 GHz band available because it's unique. And here is why. So the demand for Wi-Fi, we have analyzed it, and that's the graph I have from our 2017 study. We are actually working on an update, but the projections were that back in 2017, even that the demand for Wi-Fi will exceed the available spectrum capacity by almost 1,000 megahertz or more by 2025. And that would manifest this degradation in performance of Wi-Fi in high user density environments and in environments where large volumes of data is required. So with that, you know, different regulators, I spend a lot of time talking to regulators around the world. I often get asked the question, well, you already have access in 50, 60, 70 gigahertz band. Why don't you just use that? Well, the problem is the propagation characteristics. They're simply, the Y gig technology is certainly very helpful in some use cases and is being implemented. We actually have equipment on the market that the Wi-Fi industry, but the propagation characteristics are not there to support the kind of use cases that are envisioned for 6 GHz with ubiquitous deployments. And then of course the low band, we overcome the propagation characteristics, but simply lacks the bandwidth. So below 1 GHz, again, there are a number of use cases that are very important, but the majority of use cases require larger bandwidth than what we can get below 1 GHz. And so 6 GHz is the Goldilocks frequency for Wi-Fi because it's adjacent to the existing technology, which we have in 5 GHz. Wi-Fi been operating there for a number of years. The propagation characteristics are there and coexistence with incumbents, which is also quite important because Wi-Fi never gets exclusive rights to spectrum. And so we need to find ways to coexist and actually protect the incumbent services and operations in the frequencies that we get. So the coexistence with incumbents is achievable for Wi-Fi technology. And that's critically important from the regulator perspective. Before we do anything else, I think it's worth taking a look at where Wi-Fi came from in mid-band and where it's going. I think it puts it in the perspective of why 6 GHz is so important. So Wi-Fi, of course, been operating in 2.4 gigahertz band, which was great back when we sent short texts and emails to each other. But sharing spectrum with the garage door openers and toys and other things are not necessarily the best way to implement this technology that's basically an integral component of national telecom infrastructure now. And so of course the bandwidth is not there with 140 megahertz channel or 320s. So 2.4 is great, but it's simply not sufficient to support the activities. And then so the 5 GHz band was opened up in the early 2000s. And that was a significant improvement from 2.4. As you can see, there are a number of channels. but I think as Matt has mentioned, significant constraints by DFS. So hopefully you can all see it, but the channels that are highlighted or framed by this golden frame are constrained by dynamic frequency selection. And that limits the availability of channels and also increases the complexity of the equipment and implementation. So that's not particularly great. And of course, the both 160 megahertz channels in 5 gigahertz are constrained by DFS, and only one 80 megahertz channel is not constrained. And I think Ravi from Amazon made a very good point that majority of the users are concentrating in the bands that are not constrained by 80 megahertz. Now in US and other countries, there are additional bands available above 5.8, but worldwide, internationally, this is all the spectrum that's available for Wi-Fi. And so for the longest time, our industry, Wi-Fi industry, has been trying to obtain additional spectrum access by filling in the blanks. And so for the two world conferences, we have tried, and the answer was no. We were precluded from getting access to the spectrum. So that's unfortunate. And so that's why it's so critical to get access to the 6 gigahertz. As you can see, the number of channels that are available are significantly more than what's been available before for Wi-Fi. So with that, let's take a look at the Wi-Fi regulatory framework. Of course, first of all, I also would like to congratulate Anatel for making the decision on the 6 gigahertz for securing the Wi-Fi 6E benefits in Brazil. This unanimous decision to open 1200 megahertz of spectrum will be paying dividends for decades to come. I'm confident of that, because we have just completed an economic study that shows that there would be an economic benefit to Brazil alone would be almost 700 billion reals by 2025. That's an annual benefit. So again, congratulations to Anatel. But being a former regulator and having many good friends and colleagues at Anatel, I understand the challenge that they went through with considering this difficult issue. And it's never simple for regulators. Everyone wants spectrum, but it's a limited natural resource. So how do you apportion it? So on one hand, of course, you know, every regulator around the world would like to make spectrum available, would like to you know, enable this wonderful communication technology, but there are other users in the band. And how do you ensure that the users that are there, so for example, fixed microwave services, satellite services, continue to be able to operate, continue to even grow their networks. In the meantime, of course, enabling this fantastic technology such as Wi-Fi 6E. And so Wi-Fi 6E or 6 gigahertz is uniquely suited for the Wi-Fi 6E technology, because we can share with the incumbent users. And what's interesting, and I think this is a unintentional phenomenon that occurred, is that the band is essentially harmonized around the world, because countries around the world are using 6 gigahertz for exactly the same thing. They either use it for fixed satellite service uplinks or for point-to-point fixed service microwave links. These two services are almost universally deployed in all countries around the world. And so the regulatory solutions that we develop either in US, in Brazil, in Europe, or in South Korea, again, are applicable in all those countries, and that makes the availability of the band and the technology work for us. Just to highlight how important 6 gigahertz is, because it's adjacent to 5 gigahertz, we can reuse the technologies, we can retune the radios, and make the products available almost immediately as the spectrum becomes available, but also we're developing new products for that. So minimal cost and of course, delivering the connectivity. So the regulatory framework for protecting the 6 GHz incumbents that again are almost universally deployed is to limit the Wi-Fi or RLAN signal energy at incumbent's receiver. This is a simple regulatory technique that's how you protect the incumbents. And to manage this interference, the regulators around the world are coming up with 3 regulatory classifications for 6 GHz RLANs. And that's what happened in US, in Brazil, and elsewhere. And so these qualifications are, first, the very low power devices, which operate at minimal signal power below 25 milliwatts, and thereby limit the amount of energy that reaches the incumbent's receivers. Low power indoor devices, which operate at low power, 200 or 250 milliwatts, and are required to remain within the building structure. And why that's important is because the building structure attenuates the signal, so it does not reach the microwave fixed link receiver, or does not reach the satellite receiver, which is 36,000 kilometers above the equator. And then the standard power devices, and these devices operate on coordinated basis. So there is, in US, there is an automatic frequency coordination system, but some kind of coordination is required to protect the fixed service operations. So these devices, again, limit their power at the fixed service receivers. And to protect the fixed satellites, there is the limit on amount of energy that is sent up towards the satellite. Again, we're protecting the satellite receivers, the ones up in space. So let's take a look at the regulations that we're seeing from around the world. And as you can see, the regulations are somewhat uniform. There are variations from country to country. And I think it was not an easy decision for regulators to make, but they're all coming to essentially the same conclusion, because surprisingly, the laws of physics are the same everywhere. And so the physics works out that at these power levels, these devices can continue to operate. So for the very low power devices, you can see the frequency bands and the power levels that are being adopted. And actually the Brazil decision is a little more flexible on the power levels than US, what's being considered in US, although the industry is advocating a different solution. And then Europe and South Korea, you can see how that works out. And then for the low power indoor, there is by and large a consistent approach by regulators with some variations. But what's significant is that the most use cases and most equipment will be able to operate based on these parameters. So equipment developed for, you know, South Korean market or for US market would be able to operate in Brazil with and meet the regulatory constraints that were adopted by Anatel. And then the technical conditions for standard power devices are a bit more challenging. As I mentioned, the standard power devices require actual real-time coordination. So without being able to access the information on the deployments in real time, it makes it a bit more challenging. So we're still waiting for regulators in a number of jurisdictions to decide on how best to implement that. In US, it's been adopted. There, the information on incumbent deployments, the microwave deployments in 6 GHz in US is available online for public access. And so based on that technology, our industry is developing solutions that will enable this coordination. This is an important use case, and we hope other regulators will follow through on this as well. So really quick, just to talk about the 6 GHz spectrum. So again, it's an important component of telecom infrastructure, and the regulators are recognizing that and moving forward with enabling these devices. But what's important is that there must be a sufficient amount of spectrum made available for not just today, but the future of Wi-Fi deployments. And in that, I wanted to take a look at what's happening in Europe versus what's happening in Brazil, US, South Korea, Chile, and many other countries. So Europe is only considering 500 megahertz as at the first stage, and they're debating on what to do on the next stage. But let's compare that to what happened in Brazil. Obviously, a significant difference in the number of channels that will be available. Only 360 megahertz channels will be available in Europe, whereas there will be 7 channels available in Brazil. But what's important, this is not just for today. These decisions are made for 1 or 2 or even more decades, right? So the 5 gigahertz band was made available 2 decades ago. We did not predict 160 megahertz channels 2 decades ago, but I can predict that in 5 years or less, we will have 802.11be, which is the next generation of Wi-Fi designed for extremely high throughput to support this immersive virtual reality applications or many use cases we haven't thought of. And these devices operate at 320 megahertz channels. Well, how many 320 megahertz channels can we fit into 500 megahertz, right? So not that many, but Wi-Fi as a dynamic spectrum technology that accesses spectrum on a dynamic basis needs the channel diversity to implement this. And so this is why it's so critically important to have this channel availability, to have the 320 megahertz channels that were made available in Brazil, critically important. And before I close, I wanted to bring to everyone's attention the issue at the upcoming World Radio Conference, where again, the 6 gigahertz band is being considered for a possibility of IMT identification. For those who don't know, it's the International Mobile Telecommunications Standard, essentially a licensed 5G technology that would be considered. Well, first, this technology can be implemented already in the 6 gigahertz band. It does not need to go through the conference and for a conference decision because the mobile allocation is already there. And so waiting until WRC 23, which is 3 years from now, or possibly longer if the conference gets delayed, is simply unreasonable and is not using the spectrum resource the way it should be used. But also it deprives the Wi-Fi of the much needed spectrum. So it only leaves the 500 megahertz and 6 gigahertz band, which is just insufficient to support not just the current cases, but also the future. And so with that, I just wanted to summarize that again, congratulations to Anatel and policymakers worldwide are moving on this. We're seeing it in all the regions. In Europe, in the Middle East, Asia Pacific, obviously in the Americas, we're seeing progress being made with regulators adopting regulatory solutions to enable Wi-Fi 6E to make the 6 gigahertz band available. And we think that this is a great step forward and we look forward to everyone supporting this and encouraging regulators to continue on this track. So with that, thank you, Klaus.
Thank you, Alex, for a great presentation. Can I actually ask you to unshare your presentation there? And excellent overview and so many good points in there. And I'm also thinking that we should actually have a lot more time to discuss this because there's so much good stuff in there. I just wanted to just a couple of quick things. Number one, the VLP is as of now valid in Brazil and the decision has been made in Brazil, as we know, last week. Congratulations to Anatel for that and the Brazilians. But also in Korea, right? I think that is correct. And how about, we kind of assume that it's going to happen for Europe, or is that not a good assumption? Is that correct? Or?
Well, actually, it is happening in Europe. Sure. So VLP was made available in Brazil. It's also available in Europe, and we expect the European regulators to take their final decision, European Commission, next week to enable VLP, and also in South Korea. So the regulators are moving forward. We think that VLP entails a number of critical use cases, and the regulators recognizing that.
And so the one big thing in all of this that I keep coming back to when I think about how is this possible, is, and the single thing I think that's making this possible is the capability of Wi-Fi technology to be able to share in the first place, right? While nearly nothing else that I know of is capable of sharing a band with anyone else. I mean, do you agree with that? I mean, this is the clincher really for the whole 6 gigahertz story, correct?
Exactly, Klaus. Excellent point. Because other technologies require exclusive spectrum access. So if they use the spectrum, no one else should be using it. They cannot afford holes in coverage or anything like that. Whereas Wi-Fi is resilient enough to switch channels, find alternatives. And if channels are not available, simply not operate and switch over to 2.4 or 5 gigahertz network.
Which also really means that the organization, or the countries, I should say, that make a decision on this type of sharing essentially is getting tremendous value from using their available spectrum incredibly efficiently, right? I mean, this is part of it as well. Right?
Exactly. From the regulator standpoint, spectrum is a limited natural resource, and they can extract so much more benefit out of it without sacrificing anything or compromising the existing operations, which are very important. This is a win-win, and win for the consumers and everyone else.
I totally believe that as well, and I'm super happy that you're here, Alex, and representing, of course, the Wi-Fi Alliance, whom we do a lot of work with and we want to continue to work with. So, Alex, thank you so much for coming, and please come back and see us very, very soon again. It was a really good presentation and overview. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Klaus.
Okay, so our last speaker today is none other than Martha Suarez. Martha is president of the Dynamic Spectrum Alliance, and Martha is probably coming to, there she is. You can unmute yourself, Martha. Go ahead and do that. I'm kind of thinking she might be in Colombia or maybe in the US, I'm not sure, but she's gonna tell us now, and very welcome to you, Martha.
Hi, Klaus, thank you for the invite. I'm in Colombia, in fact.
There you go.
and I'm really honored to be here today. I will be the last speaker, so I will try to do my best to keep you interested in the discussion. And I would like to thank you, Wi-Fi Now, for this event, and also Convergencia Digital for partnering and promoting this event. So I have prepared a presentation, Klaus, if it is okay. I
would like to go ahead and share it. Please do.
Thank you. See. Please confirm that you can see it.
Yeah, we can see it. You just need to push the, there you go. It's perfect. We can hear you and we can see you.
Okay, thank you. So I was invited to speak a little bit about the situation in LATAM. And before I start, I invite you to follow all the activities. I represent Dynamic Spectrum Alliance. And we are very, very excited about what's going on in Brazil.
Martha, can I just interrupt? There's for the sake of clarity, there's a little block, sort of a vertical block, a part of your presentation that's blotched out. It's not awful. You can continue, but if you have a way of removing it, I'm not sure what it is though.
It is the screen where I can see you, Klaus. It's the chat.
It's the chat. Yeah, now it's better. Yeah, there you go. Okay.
Go ahead. Thank you. I will start saying congratulations, Brazil. You are taking the leadership. You are making a great decision for everyone in the country, and you are also taking a leadership role in the region. So really, it's a great decision. We are very glad to see that you are adopting these new regulations for unlicensed access in the 6 gigahertz band. So I would like to show quickly the situation in the Americas. So we have in this figure, you can see in orange, the countries that have final adoptions of regulations or frameworks for unlicensed access in the 6 gigahertz band. So we had first the US, then Chile, and Vice Minister Pamela Giri was explaining the reasons of why they decided to open the ban for unlicensed access. And then we had Guatemala, that modified the regulations in terms of their national allocation chart, frequency allocation chart. So they included a national node enabling unlicensed access in the 6 GHz band. And last week, we had the very good news from the Board of Commissioners of Anatel with the decision from Brazil. So right now, there are 4 countries in the region of the Americas that have open unlicensed access to the full band. And that is a very strong sign. That's a very strong message in terms of availability and in terms of possibilities for the region and in terms of use cases. So those are the countries you see in orange. And then there are also many other countries that have started the process of considering new regulations. I have included here only the countries that already had consultations. Others are also considering, we have heard about their interest, but this is like a list of those consultations that have been published. So everything started after the US decision. Costa Rica was the first country opening a public consultation in October. And then November, we had Peru, Mexico, Canada, Honduras. And then in December, we had consultations from Brazil, Argentina, and Colombia. I included Brazil there because I wanted to make a point and really congratulate all the team within Anatel, because they had the public consultation in December. They published it in December. They received 106 filings, 20 letters. So that makes a total of 126 contributions. And they deal with all that information in a very transparent process. And they have been adopting the regulations in February. So it is really impressive to see how fast and how all the effort from the technical team. So I just wanted to make that recognition because I think it is a long process. Commissioner Emmanuel explained in his presentation that everything started in May, but I really would like to highlight the quality and the diligence of the technical team in Anatel. So every country, I'm not going to go through the details, especially in those that are just consultations at this point, but every country had different approaches because we are talking about unlicensed spectrum here, and there could be different ways to frame that according to the local regulations. So in some countries, the first step is the change of the conditions in terms of national nodes to enabling unlicensed access to a particular band. Other countries have decided to publish a list of questions. So for example, that was the case of Mexico, where IFT published a questionnaire with 24 questions, getting information from stakeholders, like how could we have coexistence between different systems, which could be the benefits, et cetera. Other countries have proposed a detailed framework. So that was, for example, the case of Canada. And according also to the national process, for example, in Canada, we had time for comments and then reply comments. And now we will expect the final regulation soon. So every case is different. We also had some countries that didn't ask or didn't propose to open the full ban. And they initially asked about opening 500 megahertz. That was the case of Argentina and Peru. So in those cases, it's not a final decision. They're just getting information again. And that's what we were told. And also it has been like a long activity of conversations, of explaining what's going on. And I think this particular workshop is very, very useful. Some of the conclusions we can make from this momentum that we are seeing in the Americas region is that there is a clear tendency for having the 1200 megahertz in the band. And that is perfectly aligned with the ITU activity, the WRC 23 preparation. Because also, as Anatel explained this morning, the agenda item 1.2 for WRC 23 preparation is they are studying the 6425 megahertz to 7025 megahertz for licensed access, but only in region 1 of ITU. So that's why region 2, that's Americas and Region 3, Asia Pacific, are considering the full ban. And also it's very positive in terms of economies of scale, because then it makes, like if all the region is taking the same decision, it will make things easier for everyone. We will have more availability, more channels, and then it's really, the main benefit of Wi-Fi, it's because it relies on economies of scale. And that's why I say that this this momentum, this progress we are seeing in the Americas region, it's going in that direction, having a regional harmonization. So the DSA, in the case of Brazil, we had two white papers that were submitted to the process in the Brazilian preparation for an analysis for the band. I just wanted to refer to them quickly because I think they're relevant. And like all the participants could also take a look at that information. So one was a study about the increase in online activity in Brazil due to restrictions imposed by COVID-19. We published a document that proved, that showed that there was an additional 2.8 exabytes of traffic in the second semester of 2020, last year. And one of the conclusions of that white paper was that that additional spectrum in the 6 GHz band would be the most effective and rapid way of mitigating risk associated with spectrum depletion and expanding and improving Wi-Fi performance. So we are very glad to see that this new decision from Anatel will really benefit Brazilians after this hard situation with COVID-19. And also the second white paper that we published under the DSA was a study about the economic value of unlicensed use of the 6 GHz band in Brazil. So one of the questions is like, okay, if we are not licensing the spectrum, then there is no social benefit. And I think more and more regulators are really explaining to everyone that it's not exactly the case, that if you enable unlicensed access, then you are creating a lot of new opportunities for the economy. And that was the case of this, I mean, those were the results of this study. We found that there would be a GDP contribution of $112 billion in the next 10 years, starting from 2021, and $30 billion in producer surplus to Brazilian enterprises, and $20 billion in consumer surplus. So this is very important. We found that Brazil is getting also a lot of benefits. And DSA has also been studying that situation for other countries. We have carried out studies for Mexico and Colombia, and they have been also published and they're available at DSA website. So in conclusion, I would like to say again, congratulations. Brazil is becoming a hub for the development of Wi-Fi 6E in the region. It's not only about adopting the technology, it's also creating the conditions for a national development. It's improving the social well-being of Brazilians through connectivity. Tomorrow we will hear more details, and today we have talked about the importance of this decision for wireless internet service providers and how that will benefit those that are underserved. So that is very important for us. It's also more efficient use of the spectrum because we are protecting incumbents in the band. Wi-Fi is coexistent with the incumbents and they can continue to thrive in the band. It's attending the growing demand for wireless capacity. We had a great presentations about, about how it's increasing even in dense environments and public hotspots. There is also a growing ecosystem, and there is already an ecosystem. So that's one of the, I was very glad to hear from different industry stakeholders and also to replicate that message, that ecosystem is ready and that industry will be prepared to work in Brazil and to make sure that everyone can benefit of those equipments. There are economic benefits as a conclusion of the study. There will be new cases for people and companies, new business cases and application cases like augmented and virtual reality. Anatel is also proving a long-term vision because the fact of opening the 1200 megahertz is enabling right conditions for Wi-Fi 7. It's an opportunity to create innovative models to connect the unconnected. enabling cooperation between government, private sector, and civil society, because there are many hybrid networks that rely on Wi-Fi for the last mile. So that's also that will have an importance in the economy of the country and especially in inclusion. It will allow WISP to deploy gigabit class networks, and especially benefits are now. So again, congratulations, Anatel, and thank you, Klaus, for this invite.
I so like this presentation, Martha. I think it's so on the money. Thank you. Thanks by a huge amount for coming on and sharing that. And I just have a couple of questions for you. The first is, how much cooperation is there across the Americas on these regulatory issues on, for example, 6 gigahertz? I mean, I suppose you are to some extent coordinating some of the cooperation that's ongoing, right? Through your events and your work, no?
Well, what I see is regulators in Americas, they talk to each other all the time. There are different regional and stakeholders events. Mm-hmm. And I'm seeing that the arguments we are presenting about the value of unlicensed access in the 6 gigahertz band, it's really replying and it's really answering the questions that many regulators have, because there are many public policies about connectivity. Mm-hmm. And there have been also huge efforts to open frequency bands for licensed access. So what I see from regulators and what we are hearing from most of them is that they are open to the idea of having a balance between not only license access spectrum for different systems and different technologies, but also providing enough unlicensed capacity for these type of applications. So it's not only Wi-Fi. I mean, when we talk about wireless LANs, it's also in 5G NRU and other applications. So I really see that there is a perfect match. It's a win-win here.
Mm-hmm, absolutely. So one of the big questions, of course, for all of us, including yourselves, but and right across the Wi-Fi industry, is the question of whether to allocate the full 1.2 gigahertz or not. And of course, we have an outstanding example last week, of course, that we're now here to celebrate and recognize this week for Brazil. But have you, and there's a handful of others, as we know, have you come across any country in the Americas region that has decided, already at this point, decided not to do that? It seems to me that there are consultations, but there's no final decision on anything less than 1.2 at the moment. Is that correct, or am I?
That is correct. There are no decision. All the final decisions have been for the complete band, for the entire band. Yeah. And we only had 2 countries that had consultations about only 500 megahertz. Mm-hmm. And that was interesting because at the same time, they're running consultations about more spectrum for license access. So so we are providing the arguments. I think at this point it's more a technical consideration and policy consideration in terms of benefits. Mm-hmm. And we think that, we hope that they will hear all these arguments and we will see, I'm sure this year we will see a lot of final decisions in the region.
Mm-hmm. Martha, thank you so much for coming on. Thank you for that presentation. And I'm probably going to ask you whether we were allowed to share that, because I think there's a lot of good information in there also for our viewers. Please come back and see us again and keep up the great work that you're doing for all your advocacy for 6 gigahertz. It's a joy to have you on the show. Come back and see us again, right?
Thank you, Klaus. Bye.
Thank you. Thanks. Bye-bye. All right, everyone, that is it for the first day of this special event. And huge thanks to all our excellent speakers. Don't forget that tomorrow at exactly at the same starting time, we will be broadcasting part 2 of this event, featuring another great list of speakers, including, among others, Facebook, CommScope, Oi, the Brazilian service provider, of course, Market Insights from IDC, lots more. We'll also hear from the GSMA, many others. So don't miss it tomorrow at 10 a.m. Brazilian time or 2 p.m. CET. Join us again then. And thank you for watching. And we will try our best to share the presentations, more about that tomorrow. Thank you so much, all of you, wherever you happen to be, for joining us today. And come see us again tomorrow. Bye-bye.